As a word from the Lord, before we move further, you say, I really don't make a habit of talking about my daughter boasting, but it's a poor frog who doesn't praise his own tongue. And I got to see this here. I watched her grow up, and through the years, I watched her study the second go around, you know, to make her go in that degree. And I told her often that she was more focused this time than she was before. And to watch her study and cram, raising two children, single-handedly, and working a full-time job, and bringing them to church every Sunday morning. Her own place, you know, in my house, her own house, paying bills, and ain't had to ask me for nothing. Dime. Single-handed, that's God. And I thank God for her diligence. And the other thing, I told her also years ago, she's going to end up preaching. I know this. And I don't bother her about it, but I see it. I see what God is doing with her and in her. You know, I don't have to touch it. I just watch God shaping her and molding her, you know, and through her experiences and what happened, you know. And you can't tell folk about life just off the page of a book. You've got to live some of it for yourself in order to tell somebody else about the traps and the pitfalls that they might step in. So again, I thank God for her daughter. I'm very proud of you, man. Great, man. We got to take that on the road. We got to take that somewhere. Amen. The book of Psalms, the 73rd division of the book of Psalms. When you found it, say amen. Behold, these are the ungodly, who are always at ease. They increase in riches. Surely I have cleansed my heart in vain, and washed my hands in innocence. For all day long I have been plagued and chastened every morning. If I had said, I will speak thus, behold, I would have been untrue to the generation of your children. When I thought how to understand this, it was too painful for me, until I went into the sanctuary of God. Then I understood that end. Surely you set them in slippery places. You cast them down to destruction. Oh, how they are brought to desolation, as in a moment. They are utterly consumed with terrors, as a dream when one awakens. So, Lord, when you awake, you shall despise their image. Thus my heart was grieved, and I was vexed in my mind. I was so foolish and ignorant, I was like a beast before you. Nevertheless, I am continually with you. You hold me by my right hand. You will guide me with your counsel, and afterward receive me the glory. Whom have I in heaven but you? And there is none upon earth that I desire besides you. My flesh and my heart fail, but God is the strength of my life, of my heart, and my portion forever.
Amen.
Let us take our seats. I want to use for a subject, frustrated. Frustrated. Let's say that with me. Frustrated. Say it again. Put it in. Frustrated. Say it like you mean it. Say it like you've been there. Frustrated. Let us pray. Dear eternal, ever blessed God, we ask that you bless the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart. O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. And Lord, help me not so much to preach a good sermon, but one that will do some good so that the body of Christ may be edified by having heard it preached. In the glorious name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. And amen. Frustrated. Not angry, but frustrated. You know, I'm saved, but I'm frustrated. I'm going through some stuff, but I'm frustrated. Ain't mad with nobody, but I'm frustrated. And here, many of us have been there. Have you ever wondered or thought, you know, saying, why do bad things happen to good people? And good things happen to bad people. And if you really look at it long enough, it frustrates you. You just get frustrated. And then when sometimes these things can put you down in the valley of doubt, even while serving God, even while coming to Sunday school, Wednesday night Bible study, I hold a position in the church, yet I'm frustrated. I look around and wonder, why God, why is there no help for the doctors? They say, I have cancer, I have this or that. Why me? And I do all right, that's frustrated. Yeah. And we look around and some folks say, man, why is it, if God is God like he should be, but yet there's no cure for AIDS, frustrated. And then sometimes you might look around and you do everything. You look around and see other folks that don't even know God. Faring well, better than you are. Frustrated. Don't even believe cuss like sailors. Don't go to you going to church on Sunday morning. They at home, they in the car, they going fishing. You know, you doing that and hear you struggling. Frustrated. No, y'all. Trying to do right. You know what I'm saying? All the right thing, but you the one that got all the bills that got to be paid. And it seems like folks is out there committing crimes. You know, they got to carry in the worry in the world. Frustrated. It seems like they don't even get plagued with a cold. Frustrated. You know what I'm saying? And then, yeah, you got an old car. You got to take it to the shop. Every other month, you know what I'm saying? Something happened. And then you see folk out there doing wrong and don't never come to church. Reason by you in a new car and whatnot. And you say, why me, God? Why does this happen to me? And you look around and seem like listen, I didn't think that this would happen to me. All that I'm doing, just when I want to do right and I began to do right, it seemed like all hell breaks loose. Frustrated. I had a friend of mine many years ago. He'd been in prison in Kirkland in South Carolina, served a lot of time for Hickory. And he was a good friend of mine. And he ended up being on the 7 to 8 point of life and been in Life magazine with President Johnson. And after all that, he started a program right here in Newton. And he was getting all kind of notoriety from all over the country and finally fell sick, doing right. And there I went to the hospital to see him. He's on this hospital bed. Nurses is having to bring him stuff and what have you. Couldn't even go to the bathroom. He said, "Man, why me? Just when I began to do right. Hear all that I've been through, all the prisons I've been through, all the times I've been in the hospital being shut. But now, just when I finally began to do the right thing, in the magazine with President Johnson, people know my name, I'm in the papers all the time, but now here I am lying in the hospital, ready to die. I've got a program, I got so much that I wanted to do, frustrated." And here in the text here, this is where we find Esau. Esau is the author of this text here. And he is a man of God, he is a Jew. But he's a good Jew and loves God. And not only that, the book of Chronicles said that Esau was a choir leader. You understand? And he was a strong man of God. But then he began to look at the history. He looked at Israel's history. He knew that God is God. You understand? He knew God. But then when he began all the servant of God, he finally looks around at his environment one day, and he sees the wicked prospering. He sees that folks, nothing plagues them, nothing bothers them. He looks around, and they seem like folks is getting away with murder, and nothing is being done. And here, he is struggling. Although he is a man of God, he finds himself struggling. Have you ever been there? And he's not the only one. Job had the same experience. Joseph had the same experience. Paul and Jeremiah and others in the Bible had to struggle and got frustrated. Even though they knew God, they found themselves in a position of frustration. Esau looked around. He said it bothered him so much until it just hurt his head. You know what I'm saying? He was just anguished. And not only was he was envious. He saw the wicked prospering. The word prosperous also suggests that they were had peace and complacency, as well as wealth, as well as plenty. They had a lot of things going on. But yet nothing bothered them. Nothing upset them. They just went through life on flowery beds of ease. No problems, no children having problems. Nothing is going wrong. And here Esau finds himself frustrated. Now he begins to do what many of us do. He begins to doubt God. He began to question God. He began to think that first he looks inward. Have I done something wrong? What have I done? Have y'all been there? For me to have to go through all of the what? And some of us say, I hear some of y'all say, why me? Why me? Here we go again. Why does this always happen to me? Esau found himself right there asking the same questions. And he began to look inward. What have I done? He searched his mind. He said, I've operated with innocent and pure hands. I've done the
work of God. He just searched his walk. He looked at it and wondered and said, what could he have possibly done? And then he got to a point where many of us get, maybe this God business ain't so all made up the way you folk make it up to be. You understand? Maybe, you understand? I might need to cross back over. It seems like folk are doing a lot better. Things seem like folk are a lot better off over here on the other side. Maybe I might be a little bit too fanatic. It's a little too much church. Have you ever felt like that? When the wicked is running off and having their way, and then when you look around at the world and you see folks is getting away with stuff, voter suppression, and it seems like they're almost getting away with the expansion of Medicare. Seems like these folks are just by getting away with it. And God, where are you now? They've gutted the Voting Rights Act. Doesn't at the Supreme Court, how much higher do we go except to you?
That's right.
Where do we go? Yeah, you began to question and doubt God.
Great.
Here are our children going to school and they're not carrying class books anymore, but they're carrying semi-automatics and rifles and Uzis and bombs to school. And one, God, where are you now? This is where Esau found himself. I think I need to tell you something. Many of us find ourselves in the same place. Go and get a doctor's report. And I know I've done everything right. I go to church, I hold a position, I do all this, but why me? Why does this happen all the time that I put in? Same question. Just because we know God, and just because we come to church and we've given our lives to God, it doesn't exonerate us. It doesn't guarantee that we'll not have trouble in our lives. It does not guarantee that you won't go through trials and tribulation in our lives. I heard one writer say, Jesus said, in the world, you're going to have trouble. You're going to have trials. You're going to have tribulation. But be of good cheer. Because in me, have peace. Because I've overcome all of that. Then I read the gospel writer in John say, in John about the 16th chapter, he says, now, look here. Jesus is telling the disciples. He said, there'll come a time where they'll even throw you out of the synagogue. You know what I'm saying? And even try to kill you, take your life as they have me. And the reason why they'll do that is because they don't know the Father, nor do they know me. You know what I'm saying? He said, you can expect these things to happen to you. Esau found himself there. He said, but then he couldn't talk to anybody. You ever been there? Wonder who can you talk to about this? How am I going to sound if I say, you know, this God's supposed to step in here. And I'm looking and he ain't stepped in yet. Who do I go to where? But what did Esau say? But when he went to the sanctuary, it was there he got another. He got another view of what was going on with him. He was envious of the wicked, and he said, I was on slippery ground. I was walking on ice. I was just about to slip. lens now. See, once you come to the sanctuary, you see things from another perspective, another lens. Now, it's like something like the song writer wrote. You understand? When peace, like a river, attendeth my soul. When sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my life thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well, it is well with my soul.
Neighbor.
Oh, neighbor.
Oh, neighbor.
It's a fixed fight.
It's a fixed fight.